In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. Today's readings, both the first reading from the book of James, or the third letter of St. James, and the gospel reading, which comes from St. Mark, lead us to a line of consideration which we had not touched on very often, but which is good. In the letter of St. James, we read, "Beloved, who among you is wise and understanding? Let him show his works by a good life in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. Wisdom of this kind does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder and every foul practice. But the wisdom from above is first of all pure, then peaceable, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, without inconstancy or insincerity. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace for those who cultivate peace." Just reading that, one immediately, at least me, I see in contrast those who, I can't help it but think, no? Who think that they're serving God, doing the church good, by engaging in all kinds of, shall we say, discussion, which many times end up in critical spirit, perhaps even in ungentle or unkind speech. The kind of bitter zeal for the gospel, bitter zeal for the church, bitter zeal for orthodoxy. What comes to mind right now are, for example, those people who keep on criticizing the Holy Father for his approach, or criticizing the Novus Ordo that they contrast with what they call the traditional Latin Mass, and all those other kinds of approaches of supposedly Catholic people. And Catholic, remember, Catholic means universal, should be open to all, but then adopts attitudes of exclusivity as if they were the only ones who were right, that their way of living the gospel was the only legitimate way, and not only close their minds and their hearts, but unfortunately foment an attitude which, if it carries, will make the church very divided. At a given moment, remember St. Paul was, shall we say, bemoaning, ruining this same phenomenon happening with the early Christians, just because some were saying that they were disciples of Cephas, Peter, others were disciples of Paul or Saul, he, etc., etc., as if precisely Catholics were of different flavors, different shades. What differentiates the Catholic Church from, for example, the Orthodox churches of the East precisely is being united under Peter, even if the different dioceses of their own bishops, but all of them united to Peter, make up one holy Catholic and apostolic church. Catholic, universal. One can never speak, for example, of the Philippine Catholic Church. That's what Aglipay tried to do at the end of, towards the end of the 19th century, and it spilled onwards, of course, to up to the present. The Aglipayans are that. A Philippine version of the Catholic Church. So there's only one Catholic Church that exists in the Philippines, that exists in Hawaii, that exists in many other places. And like the Orthodox churches, they have been cut up along nationalistic lines. The Russian Orthodox, the Greek Orthodox, the Serbian Orthodox. There's even a Philippine Orthodox, a very small church based in Makati somewhere. To have a Catholic mind. This is what St. James is saying. And anything that's not that, that breeds contempt for the others or critical spirit, is not from heaven. It's diabolic, he said. Because as a matter of fact, that's what diabolus means. Diabolic. One who divides. In the same way that he divided himself from God. I will not serve. Our Lord, in the consideration made by St. Jose Maria, was not really crucified by those nails. That posture of his, with his arms outspread like that, spread eagle on the crucifix. What fastened him there were not the nails, or physically, yes, but the will to embrace all mankind. And that's what we will ask our Lord. Our Lord, let me have a big heart that's open to everyone. Like the Holy Father, like you, because that's only an imitation of you, because after all, he's the vicar of Christ. Let me have my heart open to everyone, to the point precisely of being faulted with, why do you consort? It already reminds us of the lines of the Pharisees. Why do your disciples eat with unclean hands? Why do you take dinner with the publicans and the sinners? And for the Holy Father now, why do you go to the right and to the left? Why do you open the church to homosexuals, etc., etc.? And we remember what he said. If a gay person comes to me asking to be reconciled with God, who am I to decide his intentions and not accept him if he really wants to be reconciled, to mend his ways, to stop his homosexual practices and be reconciled to God in a life of chastity, despite the fact that deep inside he will still have those inclinations because he has been broken. We can go to God with our brokenness. What we cannot do is make that brokenness an excuse for immoral behavior. Well, this line of thinking goes on to the gospel. As Jesus came down from the mountain with Peter, James, and John, what mountain was this? Well, Tabor. They were the only ones who went with our Lord there. This was after the transfiguration, most probably. As Jesus came down from the mountain with Peter, James, and John and approached the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and scribes arguing with them. They ran up to him and greeted him. And he asked them, what were you arguing about with them? Someone from the crowd answered him. He was talking to the disciples who were arguing with the crowd. He asked the disciples, what were you arguing about? But somebody from the crowd who was still near enough chimed in and said, teacher, I have brought to you my son possessed by a mute spirit. Of course, it wasn't there. It was still in Tabor. Wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive it out, but they were unable to do so. No one can almost imagine the scene. The expression on our Lord's face. Not quite of exasperation, because our Lord can never be exasperated with souls, but yes, one of almost pain. As if saying, up to now, after I've been with you for so long already, remember, this was already the transfiguration, well into the public life, almost approaching the end. And still, this thing was happening. What thing? That the disciples could not cast out a demon. They had been empowered to do that, but they weren't doing it at that moment. He said to them in reply, O faithless generation, how long will I be with you? How long will I endure you? Bring him to me. And so they brought the boy to him. And when he saw him, the spirit immediately threw the boy into convulsions. As he fell to the ground, he began to roll around and foam at the mouth. Then he questioned his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he replied, "Since childhood." Oh my Lord. How many times we're confronted with the same situation? People who are helpless. Not possessed by the devil that way, but helpless because of their wrongdoing, their wrong upbringing, their, I don't know, dysfunctional family or families. And that's the reason why they have vices, they have wrong orientations. Why are there so many people with, for example, a gay orientation? It didn't used to be that way. To the point that precisely now they're trying to tell everyone else that that's normal. Of course not, it's not normal. The only thing is, what is unnatural has become more widespread. And that because of that, we're going to say now that that's normal. And even if it became normal, meaning to say, because normal is a matter of statistics, if enough people fall into a certain pattern, then that will become normal. But it doesn't make it right. At the height of the pandemic, what was normal was for people to get it, but that's not right, and we tried to stop it. And now we have succeeded in reversing the pattern, the tendency. You see, the statistics, especially about societal behavior, is not a measure of what's right and what's wrong. It's just a measure of what the others are doing. We are the only country left now, the Philippines, that is, without a divorce law, aside from the Vatican. So it only means that all the other countries are wrong. All the other countries have fallen into a behavioral pattern, which is a concession to the frailties even of human nature. It's almost like saying, if all the other countries have now legalized marijuana or legalized, I don't know what, abortion or legalized murder, that doesn't make it right. It only means that all the other countries have become murderers. That's what happens when people are not thinking straight. Instead of being humble, recognizing what's wrong and applying the means. Because the real answer to that is not to legalize something which is wrong, but rather to go back to what our Lord said, "I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly." The church has all the pharmacopoeia to confront the consequences of fallen nature. We may be wounded, but we have the sacraments. We have the word of God. We have our shepherds. And if we just apply the means in the same way that I've seen people get out of their state of physical unfitness, for example, to become fit. Just because they apply the means, they started dieting properly and exercising properly, training themselves to the fitness necessary to run a marathon, for example. Instead of saying, "No, I'm not really, you know, I'm really like this, I'm a couch potato, runs in my family, we're all potatoes, spuds, we're a family of spuds." No. And this is what our Lord was confronted with at that moment. "It had often thrown him into fire and into water to kill him," referring to the demon that was possessing his child. "But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, If you can, everything is possible to one who has faith." Then the boy's father cried out, "I do believe, help my unbelief." Oh my Lord, how it must have moved you to hear that affirmation from that poor man. Because in fact, our Lord was saying, if you had faith, everything is possible. And he, in his humility and candor, said, "I do, I do believe, but not completely, not perfectly. Help my unbelief. I want to believe more. I have to have more faith, but give me more faith. That is the right position. Not to justify, the problem is I don't have that much faith. I haven't been formed sufficiently. I don't know the scripture. I haven't witnessed any one of your miracles. All kinds of excuses. No, he said, I believe. But unfortunately, I don't have that much faith. But even that, you can remedy. The fundamental requirement of conversation with God, the fundamental requirement, therefore, of a prayer for life is humility. It's not even faith. It's said that faith is the beginning of salvation. Well, yeah, but even before faith is humility, because faith is nothing but the humility of the intellect that bows, renders itself, surrenders to the evidence of the witness of God, even if, humanly speaking, I would even say, rationally speaking, what is being proposed is never contrary to reason, but above reason. I want to believe, Lord. Help my unbelief. So when our Lord says, with faith you can move mountains, well, I want to move mountains, but I don't have that much faith. Give me that faith. And then we echo the plea of the apostles. Ad auge nobis fidem. Increase our faith. And we even have ad auge nobis fidem, spem et caritatem. Faith, yes, but also hope. But most of all, love. Our love for you, our love for your will to be done, moves us to believe that you want us to do it and to hope that you will give us the virtue, the necessary graces to get it done. Now you see the trajectory of a soul. Which came first, the egg or the chicken? Which comes first? Faith? Faith in God, faith in his revelation, and therefore love, to want him, to want that good, and despite all the despite ofs, to hope that he will apply, he will give us the means for us to continue moving forward, which comes first. And you will see there that what comes first is love. Why should we believe when precisely there's not enough evidence for it? Why should we take our word's word for it? The revelation, supernatural revelation in sacred scripture. Don't you see that there must be a motive for that faith? There must be a motive coming from the will, twisting the arm of the intellect, so to speak, never violating it, but making it face in the right direction in order to listen to the voice of God revealing himself. And what is that, if not love? So which came first, the egg or the chicken? Love came first. But again, what's going to motivate that love? Why should I love God enough to believe in what he has revealed? Then it's a no-brainer. It's what Pope Francis has been saying since day one. Don't you experience the love of God? Don't you experience his mercy on a daily basis? Aren't you the recipient of the graces of divine providence? And then we remember the problem of the Jews of our Lord's time and why our Lord, again, rooted. You know how to read the signs of the heavens and all kinds of climactic situations, and yet you do not know how to read the signs of the times. Because the sign of the time is what he was doing. The sign of the time was, if they just were observant, that the fullness of time had come, that the Messiah that had been foreseen, that had been prophesied, was in their midst, and they still did not recognize it. They missed the cue. How about you and me? Now that this pandemic is really in its last stages, not only do we see light at the end of the tunnel, we're already at the end of the tunnel. And we don't only see light, we already hear the noises of what's happening outside the tunnel. You know, when you come out of a tunnel, whether it's a tunnel of the subway or a tunnel in the city or a tunnel of the roads go through, or you go through caves. Those of you who have been to the subterranean river of Puerto Princesa, for example, as you exit, then you see there the mouth of the cave and what's bright outside. But as soon as you approach the mouth, then you will hear the noise of the crowd outside and the birds, the fauna out there, in contrast to the eerie silence inside and just the clicking of the bats. That's what we're experiencing now. We're exiting from a period of pandemic. But then, what have we learned from it? People have been talking about the new normal, but what kind of new normal is that? And if you look closely, for those who haven't made the effort to really make a new normal, it may be a return to the old normal. The same materialistic outlook, the same corruption, the same hedonism, the same hankering for pleasure. Same lack of charity. The same putting our Lord in parentheses. The same not going to Mass often enough, not going to the sacraments with regularity. Perhaps even worse, because now we have the excuse of just going to online religious or liturgical services. And if that were the case, and woe to us if that were the case, then we hadn't learned anything from the pandemic. We hadn't read the signs of the times. And we're still falling to what St. James was ruling about and what our Lord was ruling about here. And what is that? Lack of love, lack of faith. Because of lack of love, then lack of faith. And because of lack of faith, then lack of hope. And because of lack of hope, also lack of love. Think it through. It begins with love. That's the first impulse, because of the experience of the love of God that moves us to open our mind and to believe in what he's saying. And because of that, to pursue that what he has revealed. It's the good news, after all, that heaven is possible. And so we hope, despite all our failures and all our woundedness. But because of all of that, there's a feedback mechanism of more love still for God and his will, of attaining his kingdom, of establishing his kingdom here on earth. And because of that, a fresh round of more hope, of more faith, of more hope still. No, it's not actually linear. It's more of spiraling upwards, the way those birds catch an updraft of wind. And without even flapping their wings, they just spread their wings like those hawks, those eagles. And then they're carried up by the draft. They're moving in a spiral because, of course, they're feeling where the draft is. And the minute there's no more draft, they turn until, so there's always with the updraft, and they're going higher and higher and higher. But each new round, greater elevation. That's what we need to do now. We have to end. Then the boy's father cried out, "I do believe, help my unbelief." And Jesus, on seeing a crowd rapidly gathering, rebuked the unclean spirit and said to it, "Mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And shouting and throwing the boy into convulsions, it came out, and he became like a corpse, which caused many to say, "He is dead." But Jesus took him up, took him by the hand, raised him, and he stood up. And when he entered the house, his disciples asked him in private, "Why could we not drive the spirit out?" And he said to them, "This kind can only come out through prayer." In another version, it would be, "can only come out through prayer and fasting." In other words, we have been considering how everything begins with love that leads to faith, that leads to more love. But since it's difficult to attain it, more hope still. But then just like the apostles we met, but how come I can't seem to do that? I've been attending the means of formation. I've been listening to these meditations almost daily. I have been applying the means, but how come I'm not that holy yet, as if we should be the ones to judge our holiness. Let God decide that. We just try our best on a daily basis like good children. But it's a valid question. How come we couldn't cast it out? And our Lord's answer, of course, is a valid one. Because this kind can only be cast out through prayer and fasting. In other words, there is a price to the following of Christ. There is a cost to having that kind of love, that kind of faith, that kind of hope. And the cost is prayer and mortification. We have to die to ourselves in order for him to grow in us. And we have to apply the means to pray, to open our hearts and our minds, not just once in a while, but constantly to what our Lord has to say. Oh, my mother, oh, my lady, teach us how to pray the way you did. Because when we look at the passages of the gospel where we see Our Lady, what we see her do is always to correspond to the love of God, to be prompt to the promptings of the Holy Spirit in her soul. That's the reason why soon after, or immediately after saying, "Be it done unto me according to thy word," fiat me secundum verbum tuum, we read in St. Luke, the very next verse says, at that time Mary arose with haste and went to the hill country of Judea to attend to his cousin Elizabeth. That's the kind of prayer that we should have, an effective one, a practical one, one that has consequences and not just highfalutin words and nice considerations. Oh, my mother, teach us how to pray. Teach us how to have faith in what we see in prayer and give us the love, obtain for us the love rather, because everything will come from God. She can only intercede. She can only pray on our behalf. But she's such a powerful intercessor. And she sets us all up prayer so that we too, my mother, may learn how to let God do whatever he wants. Teach us how to listen to your son so that we may do whatever he tells us. You have a few minutes left to come up with your own resolutions and to end this prayer.